A very good morning to everybody, and I'm sorry on being slightly late. I was stuck in a bit of traffic and I didn't want to start it from the car. So welcome everybody, and it's really nice, I mean, to be back. And I mean, except a week where I couldn't make it, I think we have had this continuously, so that really sort of gives me a lot of encouragement. One is that, and secondly, I was very happy with last Saturday as well. So I thought, I mean, today's topic, I think, is very, very essential in a lot of ways, because I'm going to tell you things that I think you already know. It's just that you need to sort of remember it once more, so that I can actually sort of give you that impetus. Now, I would start with things that you need to motivate yourself first, and then we'll get to the energy part. I mean, I think both are quite linked. So these are the things we as elders and as caregivers should really focus on. Four or five things which I feel that you should actually do to motivate and encourage the older adults. Now, the first thing is ensure that you have a few and manageable goals. Now, I really don't want to sound like a meeting of an MBA or, somebody who's trying to profess something, but I think some principles in life which always help, always sort of get you back to what you might be missing. I mean, there is something you always know, but you're unsure about. So first thing is try to encourage yourself to have few and manageable goals. Now, how do you do that? One is, what are the primary needs that will be fulfilled by you? One will be independence and relevance. Now, I think these two things are very, very important as far as an older person is concerned. They want to be independent, they want to be relevant. And the secondary needs that are actually fulfilled by having goals is companionship and security. Again, I think these four words resonate with old people a lot: independence, relevance, companionship, security. Now, whether you're young or old, we are always reminded that in life you should have certain goals, accomplish goals. And we ourselves, like parents, grandparents, we might even have told that to older people, younger people. So then why do we forget that as we grow older, we should also have goals? So try to get goals so that it can instill that motivation in you, know that you want to achieve those goals. So it will give you a sense of purpose. Again, the rules are the same. Try to have manageable goals. We cannot have goals which we feel we want to do, but we might be able to do, we might not be able to do. And these goals are very, very simple. Let me do 10 stretches today. Small goal. Let me finish this cup of juice. I am not being feeling that hungry, but let me try to eat this bowl of dal and maybe try to go to the second one. So these are small, small goals. Then we as caregivers should facilitate and assist the older adults in trying to achieve these goals. And once the task is complete, compliment yourself. And as caregivers, we need to compliment the older adults to actually have done the task. The task doesn't matter, because it might seem a simple task to the older person themselves, but it can make your day. It can be anyways, though, today I want to actually see the photo albums of my schooling, and I just want to finish everything and maybe write a small diary note about it. It's achievable. One is, it will help your memories. Two is, it will make you feel good. Three is, when you write down about it, you will actually feel happy about it, that you were able to express it. So that becomes great. Then the second goal that you should actually have, the second thing which will help you in motivating yourself, is have self-identity. How does this help you? Again, when you have a self-identity, it helps you in developing relevance again. And then secondary needs might be companionship and, again, security. Now, every older person has actually a plethora of experience every older person is actually a life story, and an older person has got collection of life stories. But we need listeners. We need people to listen to them. So if you see that identity is so important. Now, an older person, when they were young, I mean, they might be full of energy, passion, dreams. So why, what is the age to have to do with any of these words? If we take care of our ambitions, passions, energies, and dreams as we grow older, then I think that would also be something which we should try to achieve. I mean, what is wrong in actually having ambitions, being happy about things, trying to actually remember life stories? Why not? So this could be as good as reminisce your memories. Share stories about what you did. What through pictures, objects, the glory days, the good days, the bad days, when you lived away from home. Positive memory anchors could be photos, postcards, maybe posters, maybe your music, some movies that you fondly remember. Oh, this was the date I went on with my wife or my first girlfriend at that time. Then this is that family event where we actually had a huge gathering. This is the honor I got. This is the award I got. So these all things will enrich that older person's living. So as a caregiver, we need to give them an ear. So that is very important. And as a older person, you need to actually try to express these stories. Another way of reaffirming your identity, it would be to encourage yourself. And if not, we should encourage yourself to actually write down your biography. Now, why I am saying is it's not to ultimately to maybe sell a book. No, you never know how people you're actually motivating when they will read your story. What is life? I mean, life would be experiences. And what are experiences? They can be good or bad. So what do we do with these experiences? We actually learn from them. I mean, whatever I am saying is what I have heard from older people who I've been treating. So I gain from their experiences. And when you actually write a biography, you know about things which are happening. What is it? When you establishing an identity always makes you feel that you have great self-esteem, makes you have a sense of accomplishment, uplifts your spirit. And it just deepens the rich and vivid details. Because believe me, as older people, as senior citizens, as the generation which I cherish so much, the details that older people tell about their stories is just magnificent. I mean, these are tales which need to be recorded. And you should have a look at your own face. It lights up and there will be a smile that when you talk about, oh, this is the day you were born, or this is the day when you had your first birthday. We didn't have it in this way, but then this is the way it happened. This is when your friends came. This is the time when I shouted at you. So, I mean, those memories really give that sense of self-identity. So that's number two. Now, number three is something which I'm so happy that it's already happening and it should continue to happen. Encourage technologies. Now, what has happened in such a huge way? I mean, I keep repeating it in every talk I say because I'm so happy about it, that as and when the lockdown has actually happened, the older adults have adapted to it and they have embraced technology. So that is the silver lining of the same. So can you see what we are doing? I mean, I can see the number of participants here. These are all people who are either older people or people with older people. So technology has been embraced. So people want to come online. They want to learn more and learning has no age. So we need to encourage technology. Now, again, why that is important? Because as a primary need, you would always tend to, through technology, have relevance again. And it will encourage companionship. It will encourage your social network. Now, the internet and social networking actually gives us a plethora of opportunities even for older adults. There are flip sides which are always highlighted, like transactions, people duping older adults into making wrong transactions, they are unsure about it. No, if you learn about them, then you will never be duped as well. But of course, you should be lucky enough that people who are teaching you are people who are trustworthy. So that is very important. So this is where I feel family and friends have a responsibility that we actually don't do it for you. We actually teach you the technology, like ordering Zomato. Like ordering Zomato and actually getting you to order it yourself is much, much more different and as compared to you actually, I mean, we actually ordering it for you every time. So if we take that time to actually tell you, I'm very sure next time you'll order it yourself, whether it's Amazon, whether it's Zomato, whether it's anything else that you want. Now, why technology has become very important in the current paradigm is because it has helped in people who are living away from each other to be connected. Because video calls work really well, according to me. I know maybe that level of intimacy is not there physically, but that's the next best thing because we are able to check in with the seniors, physical, mental, emotional well-being, even without the physical intimacy. I know it cannot replace physical intimacy, but the connection is still there. So when you embrace technology, you're able to be connected. You are able to learn new things. There are so many courses online. An older adult can develop a new skill. And there is no age for actually having new friends. And any age, I mean, I would love to have older friends. Imagine the amount, and I have them too. I have so many. Imagine the amount of experience I draw from them. And the type of interactions that we have. So ultimately, that's what it is. Technology is a responsibility that we younger people also take to make sure that we try to make you learn. And then once you embrace it, I think sky's the limit because you would be able to handle it very well. It's maybe you will take a bit more time to actually learn about it, but then what's the harm? What's the harm in actually dedicating that time so that you actually have a new skill? Fourth thing, it encourages the feeling, you have to keep encouraging the feeling of usefulness. The fact that I, as an older adult, is useful. So a cognitively active adult, a person who has got good memory, who's got a sense of usefulness, will be much, much happier. So let me give you an example. We as younger people should always ask advice to older people. And we do it a lot because of we try to draw on their experience. Their life experiences matter. They are mentors. So older people are actually mentors. So the relationship of a mentor and a mentee, imagine you can professors were mentors to your younger generation, you're actually training so many younger people. And we should never say that, no, the younger people don't come to us. That's not the way it is done. Two steps they will take, two steps we take. So there is somewhere midway where we need to take because or else it will be an impasse and you'll never end up talking at all. Now, decisions making, a lot of younger people turn to their older adults. And it's not only out of respect. It's about the fact that they have seen life. So that also gives a sense of usefulness. Then I would also say that introduce certain manageable projects where you'd be in charge. And you actually try to do it so that there's a sense of accomplishment. So that is very, very important as you get old. And fourth is always we try to encourage adaptive, coping, flexible skills. Now, come on. If you have lived for long, you have adapted. I mean, it's impossible for a person not to adapt and live long. So draw inspiration from your own life. So, but how do you adapt? How do you develop coping skills? One is by having fewer but attainable goals. Always think of things with baby steps. Break it down and make it more manageable. We as caregivers should always assist you in identifying your realistic goals and helping you with it. And you can have an alternative goal also. For example, if you're not able to achieve this particular thing and you feel there is another goal you can achieve. So you should never feel disheartened. And whatever help you need from us, whether you ask for it, we are here for it. And most importantly, I feel communicating with older adults is very important to give you that energy, to give you that motivation to actually continue to do things that you want. Communication with older adults is never subtle. It has to be very frank. It has to be very nice, but not offensive. we have to remember that an older adult has got experience in life, and we don't only respect their age, we respect the experience. And it should come from younger individuals, not only because you think that, yeah, they are old, we respect them. No, because remember, this is all a life cycle. We are going to get old ourselves. So we have to prepare ourselves for getting old as well. So this is more for the younger generation and, of course, for younger participants. Then comes the second part. This was about motivating you. What about energy? How do you get energy in? Now we need to do some hard work as well. And for energy, as last Saturday, it was very well professed. One of the biggest pillars of getting back your energy is through physical health. And how do you get back your physical health? You get through exercise. So you need to have good amount of exercise. Motivate yourself to actually exercise. Have a control on your health. How do you do that? By managing all your diseases, knowing what all diseases you have. Do frequent health checkups. Be in touch with your healthcare provider. Then three, have a good exercise regimen. Remember, lockdown, no lockdown, doesn't matter. You still have to take care of your health. Have a good exercise regimen. Do necessary physiotherapy. Don't push yourself so much that you will not repeat things. But at the same time, try to maintain yourself. There are things you can take care of. Behavioral factors. Not too much of smoking, not too much of drinking. So this can be obstacles. So you need to sort of stop them from getting you to not achieve good energy. Have a good balanced diet. Remember that diet always plays a very important role as far as your energy is concerned. Then drink plenty amount of water, good amount of water, because that will enhance your overall health and enhance your experience. As I told, building your immunity is very important, not only in these times, in general as well. So try to keep your diabetes, try to keep your hypertension in control. Then try to meditate, try to have something for your mental energy as well, because ultimately positive reinforcement, trying to keep yourself motivated, is another form of actually getting energized. Then when you get up every day, please try to have a sense of purpose for your physical health as well, not only for life in general, that no, I want to achieve this goal today. I would want to do 10 walks, 10 straight walks front and back. I know maybe I'm not going to go down. I will want to drink adequate amount of water. I want to eat adequate amount of food. I want to keep myself healthy, take my medications on time, keep connected with my family and friends, keep connected with my healthcare provider when I need them. And in these times, don't worry, everybody is available on phone and video. So you can get in touch with them. So it's not that you will not. And another way of keeping yourself energized is always to be calm. Make plans which you can achieve. Physical health is as important as mental health and social health. So all these things combined together are the ones which will make you increase your energy, and also will try to motivate yourself to better times. Remember, a lockdown could have acted in a negative way also, where people would have absolutely lost motivation and lost energy. But that's not happened with everybody. People have tried to get more skills. People have got more interested in doing homework. People have got more interested in actually contributing to the house. Maybe something that they were not doing for whatever reasons before. More and more older adults are trying new recipes. More and more adults are embracing technology. So I think always thinking positive, and the bottom line is drawing inspiration from your own life. And I keep saying this because ultimately you're a plethora of, you are a life story yourself. Try to keep that motivation and energy, and try to reinstill those things in your both physical aspect as well as mental aspect, because you have to remember that an overall discipline and dedication is needed to remain healthy in an overall way. And that is something I think older adults can do, because they are very, very motivated enough to take care of themselves. Keep your worries away. Try not to worry about things which are not in your hand. Try to only focus on things which are in your hand and try to do them properly. Ultimately, that's what matters. And as they say, jaan hai to jahan hai. So we need to sort of always make sure that prevention is better than cure. try to motivate ourselves at every point in life, and we can have bad times. It's not that there is nothing wrong to be in anxious. There is nothing wrong to be actually be under stress. So you should never think, oh my God, in my entire life, I never felt this demotivated or such less energy. But that is not the point. You will still get over it, and we will help you get over it if you need help for it. So thanks a lot for your patient hearing. This was just some tips into how you should get back all your motivation if you have lost it, or continue to be motivated and get energy as well as your physical and mental needs are concerned. Thanks a lot for your patient hearing.
Thank you very much, Doctor. In case anybody would like to ask Dr. Prem any questions, just to remind you, Dr. Prem is a elder specialist from Jasloke Hospital and can answer questions which are general. He will not be answering any specific question regarding medicine, any particular drug that you're taking, but otherwise we're opening the floor to questions. Please unmute yourself, ask the question, and then mute yourself again. Any questions?
Yeah, my name is Ranganathan. I'm a senior citizen, about 66 years old. So I do not have many worries or anything, but somehow I'm not able to sleep well. So the entire day is lacking energy. Even if I want to do something, I feel like sitting in the bed or relaxing rather than doing something productive. So how to improve the night sleep?
So do you sleep more in the day?
I don't sleep. I feel like sleeping. I take a book and then, you know, I am half asleep. The night when I sleep, I get a lot of funny dreams. And but nothing negative about it. No negative dreams. But you don't have energy in the daytime, you know.
So, sir, I would say the first thing you should do is don't do any reading or anything on the bed.
Okay.
I mean, the bed is for only when you're tired and you want to sleep, maybe in the night. If you're sleeping in the day, it should be not more than half an hour. Ideally, if you don't sleep, better, because ultimately the bed is only for sleeping. What happens is when we tend to do other things also, invariably we end up getting sleeping because the mind relaxes and we will end up sleeping on the bed. So that is something which is a strict no-no. Try to maybe sit and try to read. Sometimes, of course, you might fall asleep while then as well. But that's okay. I mean, power naps are always better. 10-minute nap is much, much better than actually sleeping off for an hour and then not getting sleep at all in the night. And I would say energize yourself in the day. I mean, what do you, how is your usual day? What do you actually do as of now?
I'm basically, I'm a sort of a chartered accountant, but not in active practice. I am alone. I live in Hyderabad. So I get up at 5:30, have my coffee, then read the newspapers, go for a walk for about 45 minutes, and then gossip for half an hour with my senior citizens, friends. Then come back around 9 o'clock, have my breakfast, and then read some professional journals or read some books. Sometimes I tend to fall asleep post-breakfast for about half an hour. So then I get up. Then I go to some bank or some work will be there. Again, I come back, start reading some books, and then do some upanyasams, YouTube videos and all I see for about 2-3 hours. Again, have a cup of coffee around 3:30. Again, start seeing some videos around 5:30. I go for a walk, come back, then have my breakfast around 8 o'clock, and then sit in the bed and keep reading, and take my, I'm a diabetic and a heart patient also. So I have about 8 or 9 tablets to be taken in the morning and night, and then take a sleeping pill, Zolfresh 5 mg I take. And some days I get sleep, some days I don't get sleep. But my main problem is the energy what I used to have about 5 years ago, I do not have, you know. I feel very dull and morose and all that.
Okay, so one thing that you said which is striking is that you're alone.
Yeah.
So I think I
lost my wife 3 years ago. My son is in US, my daughter is in Chennai. So now I am in Chennai, but generally I prefer to be alone. because okay. I have a circle of friends and my books, everything is in Hyderabad. And I feel, you know, I am more comfortable there to give independence to me and others too. So that's how life is going on for the last 5 years. It has been going on.
So have you tried to develop any new skills?
New skills means, you know, I write something, you know, in the Facebook or in my select WhatsApp group. So, and I tell some stories for the younger children, you know. So I recorded a few videos and audios and sent to my grandchild and others too. And that's why. Even I get bored of, you know, learning some new skills. Some basic skills I have. But, in the mind, there is no ambition that I should be better off or I should excel or I should prove myself. That is gone, you know. I don't have it. So that's how life goes.
No, so I just feel, sir, I can sense that there is a distinct sense of demotivation with you. Yeah. You seem to be a bit demotivated. So I just feel that you will need a bit more of evaluation with certain skills. That's how you will be able to know. So to actually directly tell you that you should do this and do that will be difficult on this particular platform. But I just feel that there is a sense of real demotivation and maybe everything is just going on. So it's like just autopilot. You are doing this, doing that, but there is no sense of excitement. So that is something which is obviously, to an extent, maybe put you into an era of boredom. I'm not saying it's just happened. Maybe it's been happening for a while. The lack of a companion always affects whatever said and done. When you lose your spouse, I'm not saying you are still missing or anything. You'll always miss her. There is no doubt about it. But then the thing is, staying alone, whether you want to be independent or not, is still difficult. Because ultimately, when you get into such times, there is nobody to turn to physically. Of course, you have your children, you can contact them, everything is there. But then that's what I would want to do. I think you need to be motivated to a next level, one. Two is, I also feel maybe certain more scales will help me to know exactly what's happening.
But there, the problem is, you know, when you want to learn something new, the technology is a big barrier. And, you know, ultimately Google provides. So I feel like, you know, now I should, whatever I have learned, I should make it into videos and try to teach the poor children in accounts and finance. I have some idea. Like that, I have done it also. But now, there are so many better products, better technologies, people who are far more intelligent than you have done them significantly. You feel, you know, it is more just like also ran case rather than making an impact. So that demotivates.
No, sir, I would still say that you should try to focus on what you want to do and still pursue it, because ultimately you shouldn't kill it just like that. So I think that's the way to go forward. If you have certain ambitions, you should encourage it rather than just sort of discourage yourself because others are doing anything else, because others don't really mind if you're motivated. So that's what I would want to do with you. I think you need a bit more of motivation, which I think we can address.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, thank
you. Any other questions for the doctor?
Mm-hmm. Hello, doctor. Hello, doctor, can you hear me?
Yeah, Mrs. Dias, tell me.
Doctor, you see, now I am like, you know, when two different personalities are living under the same roof, one is, you know, full of zeal and passion, whereas the other one is just taking life like auto, like, you know, it's up. How to cope with such a situation? And even if anything is done with the zeal or passion, is misunderstood. And, you know, the spirit is dampened. I know you were talking about motivating oneself. It is so good, and that's what I've been doing. But in such a situation, what do I do? The other person sleeps for 12 hours a day, and I can't bear to see, because misuse of life and all that. it's a very, you know, between, I'm caught between the devil and the deep sea. So how to deal with such a situation when you have a demotivating person around?
No, so it's very simple. It's very simple. It's the way you look at it. According to me, one is you should not have expectations, because whenever you have expectations, you tend to obviously, and these are all self-made expectations. So you tend to get disappointed. And two is ultimately, it's perfectly okay to have two personalities. If you are vulnerable, then is when you look forward to a good time. I mean, you know from your life, you cannot have a, if you had a continuous good time, it would be boring. So ultimately, we need to battle every point of time, which you have. I mean, you must have seen so many things in your life. But I would say never get demotivated for doing things you feel are right. It's what is important is that you do. Whether you get the response is not something which is in your hands. So never try to think. I mean, ultimately, as a human being, we unfortunately end up thinking only what others will think. And that's not the most important thing, ultimately. I don't think that's the most important thing. For example, if I'll give you an example of APJ Abdul Kalam here. He only had some 7 to 10 pairs of dresses. And he used to wash them and used to wear them almost everywhere. You must have seen pretty similar dresses. He just felt that that is the only thing which was needed for him. So he, a lot of people said, oh my God, he's the president of India. He should at least have a good wardrobe. He never cared about it. He just focused on what he wanted to do. So I feel that, see, brickbats will always be there. We can't convince the world.
Yeah.
So if we go on to convincing the world, we forget our attainable yes. goal, which I talked about. So yes. we have to focus on what we want to do. And at the same time, don't expect that everybody is going to like it, because that will not happen. Then you yes, will yes. only focus on the liking of others rather than doing the stuff. So I think that's important.
Okay. Thank you, doctor.
And it's perfectly normal to be vulnerable. If you're not vulnerable, then you're a rock.
It is very difficult at times, doctor, you know, when we are faced like a resilience, we need to build up the resilience to withstand the onslaught that keeps on coming with us, especially when a person is sensitive.
Yeah, if you didn't have resilience, you wouldn't have lived long. It's very simple.
I know. But still, I need to build up more on that. Yeah.
Oh, sure. Doctor. Absolutely. Absolutely.
Thank you.
Yeah. Dr. Prem, can you hear me?
Yeah. Another resilient elder. Tell me.
You are right. I agree with Pastor, what you said. I'm also sailing in the same boat. But you know what? I have a rather thick skin. I developed a thick skin in my life. And today also the same thing. When I want to do something, everybody will say, no, you cannot do it. Now, after my physical problems, which I went through in last few years, there are certain things, even the wearing of my wearing a dress. Now they're saying no wearing saris. And I like to wear sometimes. But I am not able to wear because everybody is against me. Because they will say, if you fall, if it comes in your leg, again you will have a fall. So this is one thing. Then I like to take a lot of parts in the competitions. Hello?
Yeah, tell me. I'm hearing you.
I like to take part in the competitions. I have that, you know, the especially in quiz and writing the quiz, studying for that. Then... Secondly, I like to, I said now something I have to keep myself busy, because I am not the person who like to sleep and just while away the time. So I do a lot of Bible reading and do a detailed study, write down the notes every day. Whatever I read, whatever is appealing, I write down, because every time I can't turn over the pages in the Bible. So I know where I have written down, I can just open and check and take part in this. Though for that also there is objection. No, don't take, you get very tensed up and all, and you should not be, and don't take part.
I think, ma'am, you nailed it in the first line you said. You have a thick skin, so it doesn't matter what people say anyways.
So that's what I want to tell Pastor again. We have to develop the thick skin.
No, I think you're right. And I think that is the take home message. I think that everybody should try to do what they want to do.
Yeah.
But at the same time, know what's best for yourself, because ultimately it's not about doing things which will harm you. And I'm very sure nobody wants to do that. So thank you. Thanks for your words. Yeah.
And I keep doing my knitting. That is, this is my life. Like, I don't sit idle. If I'm listening also, I keep doing something with my fingers.
That's very good, man.
Either knitting, lot of books I got, just making notes, just right. So
congratulations to you.
So true inspiration. Yeah.
Congratulations to you, ma'am.
Thank you
for your Bible study.
Yeah, thank you very much. Thank you.
Yeah, I am a Bible teacher for adults in Kalina Parish. Okay, doctor, anybody else? Then I can also talk.
Me, please. Hello.
Yeah. Doctor, I can't see you.
Oh, 1 minute.
Yes.
I can't see you on the screen.
You can only see him when he's talking.
Okay, because I'm just getting the Tari social emblem. Okay, doctor, I have a peculiar different problem which mostly nobody has. I never sleep during the day, but when I sleep in the night, I sleep like a log. For example, last night I went to sleep at 12:15. I woke up this morning only at 9:45. On an average, I'm 65 years old and I get 9.5 hours sleep without anybody disturbing me.
So you are blessed.
When the first gentleman came online,
yeah,
and he said he gets up at 5:30 and has his breakfast at 9:00, I was calculating he has a 3.5 hour break before he could even have his breakfast. Do you think that has something very, very negative that he has to correct on?
I would say more than anything, it is a schedule that he's following, because he takes his tea. That's why I said, so maybe we would want him to be a bit more flexible. What has happened is maybe the schedule itself has got a bit this for him. And yeah, health-wise, I would say that the amount should be lesser, because a lot of people who get up early do take a coffee, this, then by the time they actually take bath, and after that, maybe he can take breakfast maybe at around 8:30 rather than 9, because 3.5 hours is huge. But yeah, I mean, and especially because he's a diabetic. Yeah, so, but we can address that, obviously, we will. Yeah.
Doctor, I'm very fond of reading. My reading tells me that as soon as you get up, you must have your breakfast within 30 to 45 minutes. If not, you are going to mess on your health. And secondly, the workout that he was saying, he said takes a walk in the morning and the evening. Maybe his workout is not sufficient.
Okay,
and that is why he is having this problem in sleeping.
Yeah, of course. But then I think it's all individual. So yeah, I mean, we have to sort of tackle it at an individual level, because he is 90 minutes of workout every day he is doing. It depends on the intensity what he's doing. Anyway, that is something we can address later with him for sure. Yeah.
So my sleeping 9.5 hours is not a big problem on my health, no? Right?
You're lucky. Getting a sound sleep with nothing moving around you is great. I would say ideally 8 hours is fine, but then it's okay. You seem fresh, so it's working well.
No, I'm asking you because I heard that sleeping above 9 hours is also not good for health. That is why.
Ideally, 8 hours is fine, but then I mean, if you get very good sleep and you don't sleep during the day, also, if you take maybe sometimes you're taking 9 hours, it's okay.
Yeah, I regularly take about minimum 8.5 to 9 hours sleep.
Eight to 8.5 is okay. Yeah.
And I'm 65 years old, so it's okay, I think.
Yeah, it's okay. It's good. You're blessed.
Hello, doctor. Hello.
Yeah.
Doctor, I have the sleeping problem. I can't sleep in the night. I'm 72 years old, and from last 10, 12 years after losing my husband, I have developed this problem. So is it advisable for me to take sleeping pills every day or on alternate days to get a sound sleep? I have broken sleep. I just sleep for 5-10 minutes, I wake up. And I feel very much disturbed, you know. So what would you advise, please?
So ma'am, one is, sleeping pills is not a bad idea, but I think at this platform, without addressing that what exactly is causing your lack of sleep, I would need more details about your medicines and all. It's difficult for me to just prescribe something. But okay. I would say we need to evaluate it a bit more, because what is the cause of this lack of sleep? A lot of things. So I wouldn't say this would be the right platform for me to say you can start this pill. So okay. Yeah, but it's not harmful, but I need to see in you whether it will be. So it needs a bit more of a detailed assessment, because I really don't start off sleeping pill just like this, because I need to know everything about you. So yeah.
Because I was advised for Restyl, you know, but I don't take Restyl. I want to get natural sleep, you know. So I was just worried, you know, that as and when can I take this pill?
Ma'am, we are not into this, you know, having a conversation on specific medicines on this platform. It would be unethical for the doctor prescribe medicine right now.
Okay, sir.
Any other questions for doctor? Please unmute yourself. Doctor, this has been a great session. Thank you very much. You've been doing this for us since the lockdown, and we sincerely appreciate it. Please do feel free to go onto our website. The recording of this will also be on our website. A recording of all of Dr. Prem's talks since March are on the website. If you want to listen to them again for tips, for better understanding. Today, there were a lot of questions on sleep. The doctor did a very good session on sleep approximately a month ago. Please do listen to that again. He had some very good tips. There were also very good tips on how to stay motivated, not only right now, but earlier. Please feel free to go to the website. And if you want to connect with the doctor, his particulars are there. If you click his icon, it'll connect you to him by email or by phone. So please feel free to do that. Thank you very much, doctor. And guys, have a very nice weekend. Thank you.
Thanks a lot.